Cities Skylines 2 had a bit of a rocky launch. It was a better launch than some of Paradox's other published games in 2023, like Lamplighters League or Star Trek Infinite, which had its support cancelled and all its developers laid off within just a few months of release. But it was still a rocky launch for Cities Skylines 2. Personally, I thought that Skylines 2 was fine. It didn't blow me away like the first game did 10 years ago, but I also did not really understand the hate that the fanbase was throwing at it. I thought it had a good mix of features and concepts from most of the original game's expansions. I liked a lot of the design philosophies of its new features, and I wasn't experiencing as many of the performance problems that other players were reporting, so I was mostly having a good time playing it. Though, to be fair to those critics, I did not have any cities with like 100,000 or 200,000 population. My biggest city was only hovering around 75,000 population around the time of the first Waterfront Properties mini DLC. So maybe my cities just hadn't gotten big enough to the point that the simulation really started to break down or performance really started to become a problem. That being said, I did have my own complaints, of course. Most of those complaints had to do with the lack of player expressiveness in this sequel, especially compared to the first game and particularly to its Park Life expansion. Well, developer Colossal Order has been hard at work trying to give the critics, and also myself, almost exactly what we've been hoping for. The result is a pair of recent game patches that have addressed many of the biggest complaints with Cities Skylines 2, and which very well might have saved this game from an early grave. If only Star Trek Infinite had received the same loving attention. The major patch was, of course, the Economy 2.0 patch. This patch sought to fix many of the complaints with the underlying game simulation that was causing many cities to break down after reaching populations in the hundreds of thousands. It also completely rebalanced the game's economy, so that balancing the city budget is actually kind of challenging now, especially at the beginning of the game. Economy 2.0 changes how zoning demand is calculated, it improves the way that citizens balance their budgets so that they can actually pay their rent, it increases the upkeep cost of city services, it adds a maintenance cost for land tiles, and it also adds a few other significant changes to the game. I'm not going to go through all of the specifics in detail because there's plenty of other creators who have done that, and you can look at, you know, Colossal Order's own videos on the topic and read their dev diaries. These changes fix a lot of the problems with land value spiraling out of control, with citizens complaining about rents being too high, and with businesses struggling to make money and keep enough employees. It also makes the early game in particular a lot harder to play. The increase in city service cost means that players won't have nearly as much of a buffer of income as you might be used to. You have to start out by building small, inexpensive service buildings and then either upgrade them to increase their capacity or replace them with higher capacity buildings as your city and tax revenue grows. More importantly, tile upkeep can cripple your finances if you buy land tiles that you aren't actually developing. This dramatically discourages rural or low-density sprawl, especially in the early game. Personally, I do have mixed feelings about that last point. One of the things that I liked about the launch version of Cities Skylines 2 was that its tile purchasing mechanic opened up a lot more variety in how cities can be organized and developed. It disconnected game progress and upgrades from population and made it possible to create genuinely rural, low-population communities such as farming or mining towns. Those kinds of rural communities aren't really practical in the game anymore, because paying for all the tiles would quickly run the city bankrupt. Instead, you now pretty much have to develop a much more compact and urban city core. Once that gets large enough, then you can consider starting to create rural satellite towns, which would be supported by the tax revenue of that urban city center. It's possible to build rural communities still, it's just a lot harder to create one that is functional and economically viable, especially as soon as you load into a new map. This little reduction of player expressiveness due to the tile upkeep costs is, however, more than made up for by one of the other big changes in the Economy 2.0 patch, a new building upgrade system that allows more freedom of placement for sub-buildings. Basically, Colossal Order implemented the exact same idea that I had proposed in one of my earlier videos back in February. In that video, I had suggested that service buildings should all have a ring around them, similar to specialized industry main buildings, inside which sub-buildings can be freely placed. Well, this is exactly what Colossal Order ended up doing. That feature suggestion video only had like 47 total views as of the time of this recording, and the accompanying blog post only has about 800 views, most of which I will admit are probably spam bots and web crawlers. Neither post went viral and very few people actually saw them. That means that I highly doubt that anyone at Colossal Order saw my video or blog post and decided to take my idea, unless they have people just scouring the internet for any obscure content from anyone who has anything to say about the game. So I'm not going to try to take credit for this idea being implemented in Cities Skylines 2. It's probably more a case of just great minds think alike, in which someone at Colossal Order just so happened to have the exact same idea that I had. But in any case, this was my idea, so you're welcome.
Is thank you.
Thank you?
You're welcome.
This change adds a tremendous amount of player expressiveness back into the game. When combined with the developer tools, which allow free placement of buildings and props, and the subsequent detailers patch that came out a couple weeks later that added new service building variants and the ability to paint surfaces without having to use the dev tools, players now have a similar amount of freedom of expression as what was offered in the original game's Park Life expansion. Players can now put sub-buildings across streets from the main building, which means that they don't have to break up their road grids to accommodate large sub-buildings. We can also put parks or zones between the main building and its sub-buildings, or, using the dev tools and Surface Painter, we can even create our own little courtyards or plazas. Paradox has also added support for Paradox mods and a map editor tool in order to give players more ways to customize their game. Cities Skylines 2 feels a lot less like an early access work in progress and much more like the robust retail release that players were expecting from the beginning. Basically, Cities Skylines works a lot better now, has far more player expressiveness, is quite a bit more challenging, and is just more fun and interesting to play now than it was at launch. Is it perfect? No, of course not. There's still a conspicuous amount of absent content. There's still very little content for creating waterfronts. There's almost no seasonal outdoor recreation activities. There's no bicycles or bicycle lanes. Weather and disasters feel underdeveloped, and on. So there's still a long way to go to bring Cities Skylines 2 up to the level of the first game with all of its expansions. If Colossal Order is looking at my ideas for improving the game, then I also want to take this opportunity to remind them and other viewers that I had a couple more suggestions for ways I think the game can be improved. In that same video about building upgrades, I had also proposed ways to make specialized industry work more like they did in the Industries expansion for the first game, which would make these zones look a lot less ugly and would give the player yet more freedom to control how our specialized industries look and behave. I also posted a separate video and a blog outlining a suggestion for the player to be able to create specialized zoning, which would be this game's equivalent to the specialized districts of After Dark and Green Cities. So if anyone at Colossal Order is watching this, please take a look at that other video or the accompanying blog post as well. Colossal Order has dedicated a lot of time and effort to trying to address people's complaints with the core game. This has forced them to delay the planned DLC that was supposed to release this year. I do wonder how this will impact the release schedule of the Bridges and Ports DLC in particular. As I mentioned, waterfront infrastructure is something that is sorely lacking in the game right now, particularly the ability to create true piers and keys. Right now, keys have to be created by carefully manipulating the terrain and using the cut-and-fill feature of roads and pedestrian paths. This process is time-consuming, cumbersome, and finicky. Piers can only be made with the concrete pedestrian streets and paths, and there is no way to create wooden piers, boardwalks, or walkways. So, I am kind of looking forward to the Bridges and Ports DLC, and I hope that it comes out soon and fills these holes in gameplay. I know a lot of players criticized Colossal Order and Paradox for starting to release DLC before the game was really in a playable state, but like they were really in an awkward position in between a rock and a hard place because they had sold, you know, the deluxe edition of the game that was supposed to include those promised DLCs. So they kind of have to provide them, and they probably have to provide them within the 2024 calendar year because that's what they sold to consumers. And if they don't actually release those DLCs, then they open themselves up to potential litigation involving, like, false advertising or outright fraud. So, like, I get the desire for the developers to fix the game first before releasing DLC, but at the same time, they have to do what they promised they would do. They have to provide the content that they sold to players. So, it's a difficult situation. Like, I sympathize with both sides, and, like, there's really no winner here. And I really do think that it's horribly unfair of people to have been so harsh on Colossal Order, because I really doubt that Colossal Order had a whole lot of say in many of these decisions. I'm pretty confident that it was Paradox that probably set the release schedule for Cities Skylines 2 and the release deadline. I'm pretty sure that it was Paradox that probably decided to create the roadmap of DLC content, and I'm pretty confident that it was Paradox who decided to sell deluxe editions and pre-orders and all that stuff that promised content that wasn't developed yet. If you want to be mad at someone for this, don't be mad at Colossal Order. Be mad at Paradox, because the publisher is almost always the ones who make those sorts of decisions. And Paradox published the game, Colossal Order didn't. So, and, like, I mean, honestly, Paradox has been shooting themselves in the foot left and right these days. Like, it's really hard to trust Paradox with anything at this point. I really hope they find a way to right their ship as well, because I do like a lot of the games that Paradox publishes, and I would really hate to see them become, like, a hated game publisher the way that, like, Activision or Ubisoft are. So, Paradox, get your shit together. Although, if Colossal Order is able to both fix the game, or at least address a lot of the complaints with the Economy 2.0 and Detailer's Patch and DevTools and Mods and Asset Editor, and also get those DLC packs out before the end of this calendar year, then, I mean, it kind of is a win-win, and everybody gets what they want. With many of these core complaints addressed, Colossal Order is now more free to develop and release those promised DLCs, you know, hopefully without the fanbase rioting and complaining that they gotta fix the game first. It was a rocky start, but I do think that with these patches, Colossal Order has managed to redeem itself and prove that it is making a good faith effort to support this game and give the player community what it wants and deserves. And hey, I mean, they gave me exactly what I wanted, so I guess I can't really complain. Thanks for watching.